Good morning, friends. Great to be with you this morning for our devotional. I pray that you're doing well this week and that even with some of the restrictions lifting slightly, that you're in good form, that you've been able to connect with some different people. And this morning we are going to look at something that a lot of people have been asking about during the lockdown. It's been one of the most Googled questions of quarantine, and that has been, how do you pray? Teach us to pray. So we're going to look at two accounts in the gospel where the disciples, those who were followers of Jesus, his apprentices, which I believe we are still today, they came to him with the question, how do we pray? And we're going to look at the accounts that are given to us in Matthew 6 and in Luke 11. So just starting with Matthew 6, verse 6, I'm just going to read. And it says, but whenever you pray, go into your inner room and close the door and pray to your Father in secret. And your Father, who sees in secret, will reward you. When you pray, do not babble like the Gentiles, because they think that their many words will be heard. No, don't be like them, because your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So pray this way. Our Father in heaven, may your name be honored. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And verse 14 goes on to say, for if you forgive others their sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, your Father will not forgive you your sins. So we're just going to unpack this prayer that, like I said, is in Matthew and it's also in Luke, when Jesus was teaching the disciples how to pray. And it kicks off with relationship. Jesus would have been speaking to the disciples in Aramaic, which was just the regular local dialect. It wasn't any fancy religious language that was used. And he's literally starting off saying, Dad, coming to God through relationship, which is radical, you know, that we can have relationship with our Creator. And if you're wondering today, how do you begin to pray? We, through Jesus, can approach God as our Father and beseech him and be call out to him as our Dad and say, Father. And the next three sentences in this prayer that Jesus was teaching his disciples really give honor to who God is. And may your name be honored, may your kingdom come, may your will be done. Excuse me. So acknowledging and adoring the name above all names, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, acknowledging who God is, that we come and we pray and we actually give God his rightful place. He is above, he is not below. That we acknowledge that God has a kingdom, that he is a king, that wherever Jesus is king and his lordship is in operation, that's where his kingdom and his rule and his reign is established. And also this recurring theme that we keep coming back to as we're learning how to be disciples of Jesus is that our will is yielded to his will, saying, not my will, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So not my will, but your will. So adoring who God is, acknowledging his kingship and submitting ourselves to his lordship so that he would be king over our lives, and asking that not our will, that we'd yield ourselves again to his will. That's how the first three lines of this prayer are set up. And then it goes into the next three lines, which is, give us today our daily bread, forgive us our debts as we forgive those who've sinned against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. So then it shifts from, God, this is who you are, and it doesn't go straight to, this is who I am. Give me, forgive me, lead me. It says, give us, forgive us, lead us. So asking for the collective, the common unity, the community of the believers. And in Matthew, which we're reading for, Matthew lands now on forgiveness. If you forgive others their sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you don't forgive others, your heavenly Father won't forgive you. When we read this in the King James Version, the word for debtors is actually trespass. So it reads, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. So often we can feel sinned against. We feel like somebody has stepped over a boundary in our lives, and they've sort of stepped further into a space that doesn't really belong to them, and we feel impinged upon and trespassed against. But the way of the kingdom of God is an invitation for us to operate out of forgiveness, that the Lord would forgive us our trespasses, which are many. My trespasses are many. But as I live out of forgiveness and learn to forgive people who've trespassed against me, then I can access the forgiveness of God in my relationship with him as my dad. And I think this is a massive thing. It's always a thing. If forgiveness is a daily thing, it's something that we live out of, but it's a really key thing in our prayer, learning how to pray to our amazing creator God, who wants to know us and connect with us as Father. But forgiveness is a key in the kingdom, that we would forgive others. And God enables us to do that, which we're so thankful for. Then when we look at how this is spoken of and accounted for in Luke 11, I'm just going to read it for you, but there's a couple of differences at the end because Luke focuses on a couple of different things. So we learn more. So one day Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us, and lead us not into temptation. Then Jesus said to them, suppose you had a friend and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me, the door's already locked and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything, I tell you. Even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives. And to the one who seeks, find. And the one who knocks, the door will be open. Which of you fathers, if your son asks him for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will he give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? This is amazing. I love how in this prayer in Luke, he lands on the fact that God is so wanting to give us the things that we desperately need, our daily bread. In this time of challenge, there's so many practical physical needs. It could be your daily bread that you're desperately needing God's provision for. It could be a need of friendship. It could be a need of comfort when you're uncertain about the future and what it holds. But the Bible is teaching us, the word is teaching us. Jesus was teaching his disciples to say, hey, ask. It's going to be given and you will receive. Seek. Those who seek God will find him. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. And then I love how in Luke it is really encouraging us to go after that, the provision of God, his capacity to provide in our lives, and actually how it lands on the greatest provision that God could ever give us is the beautiful gift of his Holy Spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit isn't just this sort of ethereal spirit. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. He's got equal placing in the Trinity with the Father and the Son, the triune God, the Spirit of God, the very Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, our teacher, our comforter, our empowerer. And just that last verse in Luke 11:11, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? This is such a beautiful prayer, rooted in relationship, speaking directly to the Father, glorifying God for who he is, submitting to his ways, his kingship, his lordship, asking him for what we really need. It's that type of relationship where we can come boldly and ask him for what we need, operating out of forgiveness, living free, living forgiven, forgiving easily, just that is our posture, that we are people who forgive because we have been forgiven. And then asking for the Holy Spirit to come and fill us and empower us and strengthen us, equip us, lead us and teach us, so that we are empowered to live out this God-shaped life in life union with Jesus, following after him, becoming his disciples, becoming more and more like him every day. There's a great book that Pete Gregg, who's the founder of 24/7 Prayer, has written. It's called How to Pray. Here's my little copy of it. That's from our college library. And that's a great book. And he uses this acronym PRAY, P for pause, R for reflect and rejoice. Maybe use the scriptures to rejoice when you're praying. Maybe read the Psalms. And A is for ask, and Y is for yield. Let's yield to the Holy Spirit and do things his way, so that we can enter into partnership with God and the Holy Spirit and see God's kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So awesome. There's a really great Instagram page, if you follow Instagram, called Unite714, and it's based on 2 Chronicles 7:14, which is that prayer again, that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, will I not hear from heaven and heal their land? So God is wanting us to pray. It's relationship, it's communication. So I really pray today that you're so aware of God's presence, his love and his provision for you, and that even if you've never prayed before, that you can, through what Jesus has done, come directly to the Father and say, Father, I want to glorify who you are. I want to ask you for my needs. I want to enter into doing life your way, and I want your Holy Spirit to come and infuse me and fill me and enable me to do life your way. And that's what God wants for you. And that's what you have the opportunity, the invitation and the access to through Jesus. So let's just pray together. Father, I thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you, Lord, that you have. I'm just so thankful for the scripture. I'm so thankful, God, that your word was written down so that we could know all of the things that you taught your disciples, Lord, and that we could walk in those ways too. So Father God, we acknowledge who you are today and your Lordship. There is no one like you, God. There is no other name under heaven or earth by which we can be saved. So we acknowledge who you are, and we come and we ask you, Lord, for our daily needs, God, for provision, for jobs, Lord, for finances, for health, for wholeness, for healing, God, for your presence that changes everything, Jesus. And Holy Spirit, we just pray that we'd be more sensitive to you today, and that we would be quick to hear you and quick to respond, and that we would grow in the image and likeness of Jesus, that by the time our heads lay on the pillow tonight, Lord, that we would have felt that we've met with you today, that we've known your presence, and that we've seen you break through in ways that only you can break through. Continue to bring healing, God, to our friends and family, those who are sick, and put courage in the heart of those who are stepping out, Lord, on the front line. And even as we re-enter, Lord, lots of different spheres of influence, Lord, as restrictions are lifted, I speak confidence into every person, and that we would know that we are anointed, Lord, to carry you, Lord, and to be strengthened by your Spirit, not by our might or our power, by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.